So welcome today to this new edition of the Fireside Chat series at AMR.Solutions. And I'm John Rex. I am the Editor-in-Chief of AMR.Solutions. And I'm joined today by Martin Heidecker, who is the Chief Investment Officer of the AMR Action Fund. Welcome, Martin.
Good to see you, John. Thanks a lot. And it's my pleasure and honor speaking with you today.
Well, it's good to see you again today as well. So for those who aren't familiar with the Action Fund, just a really brief intro from me on this. It was something that was created in the summer of 2020. It's $1 billion put up by the global pharmaceutical industry to support the development of drugs. And we'll get into that in a minute. There is was a newsletter about that link below. We interviewed the CEO of the AMR Action Fund, Henry Skinner, when he joined the Action Fund in early 2021. And today, I thought it would be fun to spend some time talking about what the AMR Action Fund has been up to since it really got going kind of last fall, right? Sort of roughly is when the team really came together. And to get into questions of, you know, what is the Action Fund now thinking about its mission and how to make things go forward? And while I'm running my mouth, let me just put out my disclaimer, which is I actually chair the scientific advisory board for the AMR Action Fund. So that may come up here a little bit later. We'll put a link below as well to the members of the scientific advisory board. But that's part of the process. And so just for full transparency, Martin and I actually know each other pretty well because of the work we've done together over the past 18 months. But we felt we're going to do this interview kind of from the ground up and talk about sort of the background story. And so that's the concept for today. So with that background out of the way, so everybody knows what's going on here. Let me just actually start with you, Martin. It's interesting to me to have somebody who's come into the antibiotic development world and the chief investment officer. You've got $1 billion to invest. So tell us a little bit about yourself. Why are you here? How did you get here?
Yeah, good question, John. And actually, I'm not here. Maybe I start with this. I'm not a microbiologist, which actually is interesting, I think. But I grew up in Germany, as you can hear from my accent. And since very early times, was fascinated by the abundance of life. You know, life on Earth is in everywhere. I think that made me actually study biology and doing my PhD, only then to realize, well, that going to a lab and doing the same things every day to drive science forward is not for me. I studied economy as well. And since then, actually tried to combine my economic knowledge with my biology know-how to drive science further by investing. So I started my career in a venture fund back in Germany, seeding companies across indications, and then later joined pharma and worked in big pharma companies, developing drugs for CNS, but also oncology indications. I came to Boston, to the United States in 2013 with the Boehringer Ingelheim Venture Fund, and joined the AMR Action Fund in summer last year to invest in antimicrobial companies. As you know, we are a mission-driven fund. It's actually very exciting, as you mentioned, to have $1 billion to invest. You know, if I would have thought of that when I was young, they give me $1 billion and I can invest this. How fascinating is that? I think it's very much needed to achieve our mission, enabling the launch of 2 to 4 novel antibiotics within the next 10 years. And how we're trying to do that? Well, through investing in small biotech companies globally, enabling them to actually spend money on clinical trials to get novel drugs approved. Initially, we aim to focus on clinical stage companies only. And since we started becoming operational, we have invested actually in 2 companies in the United States. There will be hopefully more announcements soon. And our goal going forward is to invest in 2 to 4 companies a year.
Excellent. Sort of at a You said the goal is 2 to 4 new drugs by the end of the decade. Are there any other characteristics or ideas that the fund is chasing in terms of its large-scale goals?
Well, you know, we have colleagues in the fund. We're roughly 10 people at the moment. We're still growing, so we're still hiring more people. But we also obviously try to communicate the need for market reforms in the space because, as you know, it's very tough to find co-investors for antimicrobial companies because there's low market potentials. And we believe this needs to change because as a fund who we are, we actually need value creation in our portfolio companies. So we invest today, we create value, and we hope to be able to exit those companies at a higher price compared to when we invested in. For this, I think we desperately need market reforms. We need drugs that are priced adequately, and we need access globally to those drugs. That's something we also try to achieve. What I'm personally trying to achieve with my investment group a lot, I'm spending quite some time talking with potential co-investors, institutional investors who previously were investing in antimicrobial companies and maybe are not doing anymore, trying to actually build a syndicate around a company, because certainly even with $1 billion, it's not enough money to actually alone finance a company when it's launching drugs. This is a thing, as you know, which is very expensive. So I would say this is like our three main activities, talking with founders, talking with young biotech companies around the world. We have a lot of discussions in Asia, even more in Europe. And as you would expect, most of the companies come from the US. Talking with co-investors, and also talking with stakeholders, with influencers in the space to actually get the market reforms in place that we need.
Yeah, market reforms, I guess that's another way of saying things like the UK Netflix model, things like the Pasteur Act in the United States. And regular readers of the newsletter will definitely know that there's a been a steady stream of activity in that regard. And we're very excited to see what the UK has done. And we're hoping other countries are going to move along. I guess we'll put below some links to Pasteur, links to, there's a recent interesting paper out of Europe about why transferable exclusivity was a good tool for Europe. Not every country can use the same sort of economic lever. Coming back to this notion of it being a fund, I think that's an interesting characteristic of what's going on here. Traditional funds are seeking, substantial payouts over time, 3 to 5x targets, for over a period of time. Does the Action Fund have a comparable fund goal?
Well, I think, first of all, we are mission-driven, which a little bit differentiates us from pure, institutional funds. Still, I think there is the expectations that at least we can return the money that was invested. Yeah. Okay. There's certainly not the expectation on us to multiply our LP's money. This is really meant to support companies that otherwise cannot raise money, and this money is desperately needed to launch drugs. And as you might know, when you look at the databases and you look at the amount of money that's invested in antibiotic companies worldwide a year, this is like less than $100 million. Comparing that with other areas, it's just such a gap, and we try to a little bit work on that and closing this gap a little bit.
Yeah, and I like your comment about looking for co-investors. It makes me think about that recent Milken Institute report, and put the link below about the newsletter about that, where they observed that if there was an adequate pull incentive, something like Pasteur or various sorts of things, that would have a multiplier effect with money in the space. And are you seeing that happen? I mean, you say you've been talking to people about building a syndicate. Is that common?
Well, I mean, you know, what investors look for, and I think that's not surprising, is they want to have a stable and safe environment, right? Yeah. So when people talk about reforms that might come, but also might not come, that's not a stable environment. You look, so I think currently people are not, investors are not motivated to invest in antibiotic companies for like a pull incentive like Pasteur. But I'm obviously using it in discussions, because what we will do here in the AMR Action Fund, we will build the biggest portfolio of antibiotic companies. And so if those reforms happen, we have all the companies that might actually benefit from this. And that's, I think, a pretty interesting idea, together with the fact that we have $1 billion to support this company. A lot of what I see today in the space, John, honestly, is the result of very, very limited resources. Yeah. And many of the companies I see, comparing that with other areas I invested before, have to deal with very, very limited resources, personnel. It's very challenging from them, for them, and they're heavily depending on non-dilutive funding coming from various organizations.
Yeah. I say that, you know, I mentioned earlier that I'm the chair of the scientific advisory board, and one of the things that attracted me to doing that was the notion that the Action Fund has enough money to be able to look at an interesting product and say, you guys are running on a shoestring. And if you, yes, you need to do the sort of the nuts and bolts studies, but if you want to make this product really sing and dance, you actually need to do this other study or plan for it. And the Action Fund is in the position to support that kind of work, the kind of work that creates the wow factor that supports a compound being something attractive enough that it can earn a good size pull or a market reform award. Talk a little bit about process. If I'm a company, I want to get on your radar screen, how do I do that? And what would make something of interest to you? Are there things to, you know, again, if I'm a small company and I'm thinking I'd like to get the Action Fund to notice me, maybe I've got some CARB-X funding, and now how do I get on the Action Fund's radar? What do I do?
Yeah, not very surprising either. Write an email, right? Give us a phone call. Meet us at conferences. So I would say this is the three main, doors to us. And we go to the big conferences to actually meet people we know already, but also get to know new people. We obviously are in close contact with organizations like CARB-X, and we know we are aware of their portfolio. But the good old way is always to meet people and say, hey, I'm doing something interesting and you want to have a look at it. And so we typically start with a phone call. It's a non-confidential presentation, so nothing is strictly confidential. And if we like the conversation, if we like the concept, we actually sign a CDA and we go into a confidential discussion. We get access to the data room that those companies typically have. And then it's not only about the science anymore, which is our starting point and maybe initially the most important thing, but it also goes about what contracts has this company, closed already. What is the team? Who is on the board? Who are the investors? What is their vision? How do they want to implement their idea and make it a product, which is not trivial? And as you know, especially for small biotech companies, their expertise is more the research and the science rather than the commercialization of drugs. We invest in clinical stage companies, so commercialization actually is happening soon.
Then
we have the discussion, and it's maybe worthwhile talking about that, John, with the scientific advisory board, right? I mean, we have a lot of discussions, which I have to say I really enjoy because I still learn a lot. Yeah. And maybe, I don't know whether you want to comment as being the chair of the scientific advisory board a little bit.
I think I should do that for just a moment. And everything you've described up to this point is classic venture capital. You know, you have a group of basically investment advisors. And I think it's interesting that your background is that you're not a microbiologist. You're a biologist interested in economics who is applying your scientific understanding to support the whole process of developing drugs. And I actually think that's a really valuable place to start. You know, Kevin Otterson, who came in to run CarbX, I think in many ways, the fact that he's a lawyer and is not a biologist at all, but has learned the area well enough to know to appreciate the drugs. It's very powerful, actually, to come from a different discipline. And so the Scientific Advisory Board, I think there are about 9 or 10 of us at this point, is a really interesting and diverse group. We have people, in Japan, Australia, Europe, the United States, no surprise. We have got microbiologists and chemists. We have got people who've done large pharma. We have got people who've done small pharma. We have got deep academic infectious diseases experts. We've got somebody who used to work at the FDA. We have got somebody at WHO. We have got somebody from CARB-X, who sits on the Scientific Advisory Board. So we're really trying to connect all of the ideas. And the process of identifying that group was one of about providing global input, balancing skills, and being able to give a good perspective. And I think what the SAB does is really work on the science side of it. Does the story add up? What are the things that everything has a gap, everything has a flaw, everything is something you got to work on. And how can you identify those things? And then what can you do about them? So the fact that a product needs to solve X or Y is not, that's just what is. The question is, can the team to pick that up and do something about it? And the SAB has enough people on it who've had their fingers burned enough times in development projects that we have a pretty keen sense of where the landmines are in the road that the company's going down. That's the role of the SAB. But it's been interesting to me, though, to watch how it's very venture capital. Like you take that advice and you go, okay, that's what the scientific geeks think. What do we do now with this in terms of an investment opportunity? And I think that to me is always that's the part where I sometimes am I'm not as deep in the finance side, and I'll watch you guys think about, well, this company has done that kind of a deal or this other kind of a thing, and it's going to be hard to work with them for one reason or another. So if you want to talk about what would make, so you said the company needs to have a good team, needs to have a good product. That's pretty straightforward. What else is really going to make a difference in terms of the Action Fund's ability to invest?
Well, at the end, when you do diligence, when you actually assess whether you want to invest in a company or maybe not, it takes a while. This is nothing that comes overnight. So you spend maybe 2, 3, maybe 4 months with the team, you discuss with them, you go through data, you actually interpret data differently, you get to know their network and their ideas. And as you said, you have your internal network, you have your SAB, you have other experts that you talk with. And at the end, what I want to make sure before I invest, that I really believe this drug has a chance to be launched. And also this drug has a space in the market. So it will be needed, it will be prescribed by physicians, with or without pull incentives, by the way. So is that a me too? Is it slightly better? Does it kill multi-drug resistant bacteria that others cannot drug and cannot kill? And what we always want to make sure, and I forgot to mention that, we focus exclusively on critical and high priority pathogens according to CDC and WHO lists. So you need to actually focus on the right bacteria. And then at the end, it is a discussion within the team. Everybody is heard and there's a vote. We have an investment committee. There's a presentation and you are part of that as well, John, as you know. And sometimes not everybody is of the same opinion, but there's discussions and then there's a decision, and the decision actually is leading then into an investment and hopefully into a new drug within the next 10 years, right? Because that's what we all want.
Yeah. So you mentioned the notion of innovation and Me Too. And, you know, there's a sort of a constant conversation these days about what is enough innovation and what kind of drugs should we be buying? And and I think if you look at the Action Fund's first two investments, right, were in a beta-lactamase inhibitor combination and in phage.
Right? Yeah.
And talk a little bit about how you think about innovation and risk and in terms of novelty. And I if you don't pick it up directly, I'll actually I'd like you to think about the idea of the non-traditional products as well, because there's been a lot of interest in non-traditional. So
yeah, absolutely.
Innovation, risk, how do you balance that? What are you looking for there?
Yeah, and I think it's a good example and a good idea to actually start maybe with the investment that we made, the two portfolio companies we have, Venatorix, one of them, classical beta-lactamase inhibitor company, a group of drugs very widely prescribed. And this company actually developed a beta-lactamase inhibitor with a broader coverage. So it not only can kill the serine, but also metallo beta-lactamases. And this is certainly an interesting spectrum. Will this, be used for the next 10 years, or will there be drugs, bugs becoming resistant again against this combination? High likely. So maybe a company that's very far advanced, they actually had phase 3 data before we invested, so we know it works. No clinical or very limited clinical risk anymore. I think the risk here is more in the CMC and in the filing process. But a very traditional combination of drugs that's been in use since like 40 years with a better spectrum. And then on the other side, a phage company, right? A virus that kills bacteria, very selective, never really showed efficacy in a clinical trial. And with this novel idea, we believe that we can drive boundaries of innovation. So what APT does, Adaptive Phage Therapeutic does, they have collected phages that they actually have in a phage bank. And then they treat patients suffering from chronic indications like diabetic foot osteomyelitis or prosthetic joint infections. And they actually treat these patients individually. So you take bacteria out of the patient, you test which one of your phages in your phage bank is killing this specific multidrug resistant bacteria, and then you treat this one patient with a combination or only one of those wild type phages. They're not genetically modified. And another patient in the same clinical trial will get a completely different phage. And this actually is the innovation that we see here, that FDA treats this as one product, even though it's many, many phages that are in this phage bank, able to treat patients very individually. And when you think of oncology and other indications, that's a trend that we see. We don't see that in antibiotics so far. You know, it's like one pill kills all. But here, very individually, very adapted. And that was certainly something that motivated us to invest in adaptive phage technologies. There's other innovative approaches out there that I hope will become more important when it comes to treating bacterial infections. There's companies aiming to modulate the microbiome. There is companies using phages. Other companies are, you know, trying to stimulate a patient's immune system. So not fighting the bacteria directly, but enabling the patient's immune system to recognize and kill the bacteria. All of those I find very promising, because I certainly believe that the probability of developing resistance might maybe be not as likely as with the traditional approaches. And we need both. For solving the problem, I think we need the traditional as well as the more innovative approaches. And each of them comes with completely different risks. And I mean, we have discussions in our scientific advisory board about how to best do a clinical trial with a very targeted therapy. You only kill one specific bacteria. The question is, well, How many patients are suffering from this specific bacteria, you know, versus maybe other pathogens? And that's actually the complication that we see, obviously, when we focus on more innovative approaches. But that's the fun. For me, this is really the fun part of it. And yeah, that's when it becomes interesting.
Yeah, I have long been fascinated by the idea of some of these alternative strategies. And you mentioned, you know, flipping on the immune system, blocking toxins, that sort of thing. I mean, is it scientifically, it sounds like it ought to be a great thing to do. And the development hurdles are enormous in those products. But I guess, for me personally, speaking as just part of your SAB, you know, my hope is that if we can identify companies that really have a compelling path forward where they've thought about the problem, and I'll just say that, you know, that when I lecture on this, I talk about the notion that I'm not raising the difficulties just to be difficult. I'm raising them because actually, if you're going to do something that's really different and needs a different endpoint, a different way of measuring the response, you have to build that in. And you know, one of the things the Action Fund, you know, has the scope to do is to help, you know, fund the work that's required to get that sort of thing done. I mean, there is a sort of a community level conversation that needs to be had about how much data are required to approve drugs for limited populations of patients. And that's a conversation that's also going on, sort of slowly, but it certainly is happening. So I'm with you on the innovation risk thing. And it's been fun for me to listen to you guys talk about, you know, how a venture capital group might have that kind of risk in its portfolio. And I think that's really an interesting bit of strategy that the whole thing is going to play out. So if things get approved, if we imagine a couple of drugs come down the pike, what are the availability requirements for new therapies? You want to talk, you know, I know that, you know, Carbex has their stewardship guide that they were developed with Welcome and GuardP. And I'll put a link below to the newsletter about the stewardship guide. Where is the Action Fund on availability and access?
Yeah, of course, we try to actually encourage our portfolio companies providing access to also low, medium income countries to this novel technologies. We talk a lot with our friends from Carbex. We talk a lot with our friends from GARDP, organizations that actually have the same goal. And we think a lot about what can we do together. Many of our portfolio companies actually have existing contracts with GARDP and others for this reason. Yeah. And so I think we all, you know, I mean, resistant pathogens travel, right? And I mean, when you travel to India, in your gut, you bring with you high likely multi-drug resistant pathogens. So this is a global threat. It doesn't stop. And we have to make sure that we provide solutions anywhere on Earth and not only in the high income countries.
Yeah. Yep. Those bacteria do not respect TSA pre-check. They're going to travel right along with you. They're not held back by anything. That's right. So last question. You've now been with the Action Fund for a year and a half, about?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What's the thing that has surprised you the most?
That's a good question, John. What did surprise me? I'm maybe not surprised, but I would say I admire the motivation and persistence of founders in the field, I have to say. And I always felt that, even investing in other areas, it's so challenging to talk with 1,000 people to get some money, right? In this field, in this antibiotic field, you maybe have to talk with 10,000 people to get some dollars. And people are dedicating literally their lives towards launching an antibiotic drug. And they do that because they are convinced this makes a difference.
Yeah.
And that's certainly something, and not surprising, as I said, but I really admire those individuals, because we need them. Because if people give up in this space, I think we will facing big problems, you know, and we have all those prognoses talking about how many million deaths we will have in 2050 if there's nothing coming. And so we need those individuals to actually stop this. And this is a great pleasure and fun for me to talk with those people, but also to be able to invest in at least some of those, helping them to actually achieve their goals.
Yeah, the requirement for a little bit of irrational optimism. I mean, discovery is so hard. And unfortunately, most projects ultimately fail, but it's that thing about getting up and starting again, getting up and go again, that actually makes it happen, doesn't it? Yeah. Wow. Well, it's great to chat with you today. And, fun to sort of think back about what the Action Fund has done to date and how it's going to go forward. And I really look forward to seeing the next few investments come along. I gather you've got your sights on a couple a year for the next few years. Is that kind of the goal?
Yeah, 2 to 4 novel investments a year. That's our goal. Let's see how it works. So we did 2 this year. There might be a third, maybe a fourth announced as we go. It will be maybe a little bit close to year end, but we in deep discussions with a couple of others. So I'm not concerned that next year we certainly will have a portfolio of maybe 5 to 6 companies and continuing to do so.
Fabulous to watch it happen. So again, thank you. Been a pleasure chatting with you this afternoon, and stay safe. We'll be in touch.
Thanks a lot, John. Have a nice rest of the day. It was my pleasure. Take care. Bye.
What fun to get to visit this afternoon with Martin Heidecker, the Chief Investment Officer at the AMR Action Fund. Really interesting to hear how he thinks about the fund and where it's headed in the future. And I've been excited about the Action Fund since it was founded. It's a marvelous concept. And so looking forward to seeing it deliver stuff. And I hope you enjoyed the chat as much as I did. Just super stuff there. Thanks for being here today. Thanks for dialing in. As always, like, comment, and subscribe for more. See you next time.